Hi everyone, welcome to another show of the Spinners Lounge. It's been a 2-week break and I'm glad we're back now and we've got another guest and we're out here on a beautiful sunny day. And before I get started, I'm going to let my guest introduce himself. Please, Stuart.
Stuart Mitchell, DJ out of Hertfordshire, deep soulful house all the way.
Right, as with the Spinners Lounge, or what the format's always been, it's always been before this, was to actually sort of put out an ad and let people apply. But with Stuart, I think there was a little story. One day I was on Google Plus, I don't know how, but you end up following me on my normal profile, but then I think it was something House Destiny or something like that.
House Beats UK, is that the...
Yeah, something like that followed me, and I was like, wow, who's this? And I listened, obviously, and what kind of struck me about your profile, now, to tell you the truth, was obviously you got this DJ, and then it was like the honest sort of description in the profile, which was, I got a normal job, I work for Fairview Homes, and I thought, you know what, that's kind of the spirit of the Spinners Lounge, because obviously, like I told you before, I'm looking... not necessarily looking for people, but I want people who have a normal sort of life as well. Do you know what I mean? DJing is a big part of it, but also they have a normal life. Yep. So when, obviously, we connected, it took a while, but we got through it, and then, obviously, it's led up to where we are today. So with the Spinners Lounge, what we normally do is, right, we've got a series of questions, yeah?
Yeah.
And the whole point of these questions is to kind of understand who you are a little bit more, obviously, and the journey you made from, obviously, liking music, buying decks, and then going out, playing that, you know what I mean, that kind of thing. So, what we do is we start off with music, right? Now, we're going back to probably when you're a teenager, or I always say the earliest memories you can have, because when I say to people, take me right back, everyone starts thinking, oh, no. The memories you can remember when music had a real influence, you know, like the point where you say, right now, I like this kind of music and I like this kind of artist. So growing up, what was the kind of music you listened to?
So growing up, my first musical influence is, my mum and dad are music lovers, they had a massive record collection. Okay. And my dad really loved Motown and all that sort of stuff, the OJs, Temptations, all that sort of thing. So I really like that sort of stuff, music with feeling from a young age. Mm-hmm. And that sort of set the tone for later on. Loving soulful music, basically.
Okay.
First record I ever bought was Shalamar.
Okay.
In 1981. And I was 7 years old, so that sort of says it all, really. Yeah. I'm asking my mum and dad to buy me a Shalamar album at 7 years old, and everyone, all the kids are listening to, I don't know, Farmyard Animal songs or something like that, you know. But, so just sort of went from there, and then through the 80s, obviously, boogie music, disco, Earth, Wind and Fire, all that sort of thing. So I loved all that stuff.
Yeah, even just while you're talking about that, where did you grow up? Was it, because obviously we're here near Stevenage. Okay, so have you always grown up around here? Or?
Well, I grew up in Stevenage, Hertfordshire. Mm-hmm. I've moved about, to about 22, and then I went to Tenerife. We'll talk about that in a minute anyway. Mm-hmm. So I went to Tenerife, come back. I've lived in various places in London. Got married to a girl from Dulwich. Last year I've been with for 6 years, and she wanted to come out in the sticks and see a bit of countryside, and the three dogs as well love it up here as well, so that's what we've done. Plus it's half the price to buy a house up this way.
Yeah, so. of course. That's a different story when we get into that house. Buying houses, renting, and that's cool. But now let's go back to that, obviously, in saying your mum and dad, and it's nice just obviously for you to say that as well. I mean, because so much different people, as I say, have different influences. So sometimes it comes from outside, sometimes it comes from inside. So it's nice to have your mum and dad. Were they musicians themselves or just music listeners?
No, just music lovers.
Okay, cool. And do you have any other brothers and sisters as well? Or?
I've got an older sister. She's not even involved with music or anything, but she's also a music lover as well.
Okay, cool.
She always catches blasting out of stereos when we're younger. Trying to fight each other with a volume through the bedroom.
All of us did this. I mean, because remember, listen, anyone who's probably younger, you know, things that you see today, you might take for granted, but believe you me, when you had one hi-fi system in your house and there's a couple of you, listen, it's a battle. So trust me, things have changed. Right, so taking on board that you've had this soulful experience, like with Shalamar, I can imagine all the different acts and musicians at that time as well. making the transition from what you personally liked and then transition to kind of then starting to become a DJ, right? When was that actual transition? When, you know what I mean? Because obviously you started liking music from 87, so now, what, we're talking, what, 13, 14, or a bit younger. When did you start, like, thinking, right, or the DJing element came into your life?
16 years old.
Okay, 16.
I was buying vinyl and all that. Didn't start straight away. I was buying records before I started DJing.
Okay, okay.
And then my other friends were doing it, and a couple of, they had a pirate radio station going at the time. Its name escapes me now, but didn't last very long. But I stuck with it, and they sort of faded off.
Okay, okay. So, generally, like, was it because the other kids where you were at that particular time were DJing, or, like, was there a particular influence that said, nah, this is what I want to do? Like, for example, was there a DJ that you then liked at that age and that's made you think, you know what, I want to do what they're doing?
Well, before I was 16, I was about 14, 15. We could pick up in Stevenage, funnily enough, we could pick up Centre Force, Fantasy FM, Sunrise,
and all that.
And I'd be sitting there on my tape Walkman, listening to the radio, listening to the Pirates radio stations, you know what I mean? And all the other kids in school weren't really into that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And sort of going on from there, DJ Hype, Loft Groover, or Aslan Mac off Rush FM and people like that.
Yeah, Rush FM was probably one of my favourite radio stations growing up because I wouldn't say he's a close friend, but he's a friend of mine, a good friend of mine. I don't know if you remember DJ Red Ant.
Yeah.
We did an interview quite a couple of months back with him, actually, and we were talking about the weekend rush days and that kind of thing. And I've always said to him, that particular period of time influenced a lot, particularly in youth culture. Yeah, do you know what I mean? Because raves, the flyers, the dressing up. It just, you know what I mean? It covered everything, you know what I mean? So
that was a lot bigger back then as well. When you see kids these days, my stepkids, oh, I'm going to a rave. I'm like, no, you're not going to a rave. Raves had like 20,000 people at them, massive systems and everything else, playing underground music. Mm,
true, very true. Like, again, my own personal opinion anyway is that raving, from what we knew, or back in those days, and what's happening now is completely different. But then I suppose it's their time, it's their thing to do it. Okay, cool. So we've taken that on board. You start making you start playing that. You've got records already. How long soon after that did you then sort of take it even further and then maybe start playing that? And where did you play that? Because obviously coming, I don't want anyone to take this the wrong way, but our era when we grew up, you know what I mean. A lot of people sort of made the transition from the bedroom to the radio station and from the radio station to a party, and then, you know what I mean, it just went on. So for you, what was the transition and how did it happen for you?
Well, there was around 91, I've been doing it for a while, there's a local radio station called Impact FM.
Okay.
That was playing hardcore and sort of the Euro breakbeaty stuff then, and I started on them. I lasted with them for about 6 years, but at the beginning, I started doing house parties. I had a lot of friends, West Indian friends. They'd have blues parties, playing reggae and all that. And by 92, 93, when I was playing jungle, drum and bass, they'd invite me to come along and play.
Okay.
Whereas a lot of tracks, reggae and ragga tracks, are sort of half speed of the jungle.
Mm.
I was mixing up jungle with reggae and all that. Okay. Other tracks were around at that time being made, jungle with ragga in them, but I was actually playing instrumental sort of drum and bass with the ragga in the background and that.
Okay.
And then after that, local place called Bo's Lion, which is a like youth house. They used to have parties there, under 18 raves, and I played with Slipmat, DJ Rap, Dr. Escache, Swanee, LSD.
Some good names there. Some good names. Dr. Escache, DJ Rap. That's good.
How old was I then? 18.
Okay.
So, there wasn't really a lot of DJs in the town, to be honest. There was a couple of well-known ones that had been doing it for like 10 years, older than me. And that were playing in London and things like that at the time. But, so that's where it all really started, playing clubs and bars, and it just sort of escalated from there.
Okay, cool. And then, obviously, starting off roughly about early 90s, going up, the style of music, obviously, because I think when we spoke on the phone recently, you kind of described it as you started off as Euro House and then it kind of morphed into kind of, as we discussed, the link between kind of the hardcore, jungle, breakbeat, garage. So what was the musical journey in terms of that DJing, the style and all that kind of thing?
Well, from about, like I said, Euro into Euro breakbeat about 1991, and then hardcore came along, not happy hardcore, by the way. hardcore before happy hardcore. And then from about 92, late 92, 93, you'd had LTJ, Booker and people like that, producing drum and bass on good-looking records, and then a lot of others. I was more into the Amen break sort of stuff to start with. So I was playing that up to about 95. And a few of my friends were going out for a party, going out for a birthday party down to La Cosa Nostra, Leicester Square. And there was like, oh, we're going to this garage thing, house and garage thing. What? House and garage, that's girls' music. You know what I mean? Because I was playing drum and bass and jungle and all that. I went down there and it just changed me, really. And the song that made me realise I actually like that sort of stuff was Tough Jam and Tyree Cooper, History of House.
And that was for me, really.
There was a club, local club in the town called Renaissance, that were playing house. And I approached them, and I just started playing garage as well. Approached them about playing garage. They weren't up for it at the start, so I started playing house. And I got in there with playing house. I was getting more plays out, basically, as if I was playing that than drum and bass. And I didn't know the way drum and bass was going anyway. So I'd play house, and then eventually as garage sort of progressed and it got a bit more, not mainstream, but more people liking it. Still only a London thing, really, at the time. I convinced them to start putting garage nights on. So instead of having on Friday night and a Saturday night, all house every weekend, they changed the Friday to a garage night and the Saturday to a house night.
Okay.
I was resident there for 5 years.
Wow.
And then eventually, I told him to stick with it. I said, look, that garage is going to be a big thing. Stick with it and it'll work. And eventually it became garage on a Saturday night, garage on a Friday night. And we had all the big notes, Cole, Matt Jam, Lamont, Timmy Magic, Mikey B, Spoonie, all them boys up there. Mike Roughcut.
The garage, you know what, it was a good time, actually. Because from what I kind of remember anyway, when the garage was coming in, there was house as well. And I think they both kind of sat nicely together. Then the garage maybe got too big for his boots, and it's like everyone, and it was like his own music genre and all of this kind of stuff. It was a good time. So obviously with that experience there, 5 years playing at the club as well, what happened after sort of that period of time?
After that period, around 97, one of the promotions companies started taking over and doing things at the club called Garage Experience, which was Paula Sir and John Fernandez, an old gas club and Coliseum DJ and all that. And they asked me to play for them, and I was playing for them for their promotion, becoming a resident for them as well. John was also playing out in Tenerife at the time. He couldn't make the next year. He asked if I wanted to go over there and start playing in Tenerife. So in 97, a few things happened personally, split up my girlfriend at the time sort of thing. And I thought, you know what? I'm off. I moved to Tenerife in 97, come back from there 2002, but coming to and fro in between anyway, because the seasons.
Yeah.
And he's just playing garage out there. The only club playing garage at the time, as you can imagine, we had Bobby's and Busby's and all the big clubs out there all playing commercial house, and we was playing garage. So anyone from London that come out to Las Americas, the club was called Rara's at the time and then changed to Escape. Okay. Anyone that come out there from London was always in our place, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But eventually it got bigger, all the other places started playing it, and that's when it all started getting a bit commercial. And I was playing, when you're playing every night, 3 hours a night for 5 years, it sort of takes its toll on you.
It must be.
You're playing the same songs over and over again. There were record shops out there, but I'd be relying on people coming out on holiday. I'd phone a record shop saying someone's coming to collect, give them all your new stuff. They'd come out there, so that's where we're getting new records out there and that. So, but after a while, it's just playing the same thing over and over and over. You try and mix it up a bit and try and do things different, but there's no way of getting out of it. So, 2002, I come back from there. I sort of hung up my headphones for a little while because I was a bit lost. I didn't want to play garage anymore because I didn't like what was being made. I was listening. I was basically, for a couple of years, I was just listening to the boogie and disco and soul CDs in the car.
It's like you said, it's that particular time as well. It's kind of funny because I think when garage, I'm speaking in my own experience anyway, when it kind of, like you said, I don't know, maybe around the end, just before the millennium, we just kind of died. Like you said, there was a bit of limbo as in what direction, because I remember listening to Steve Lawler on Kiss FM, and I didn't know who he was, and it was just like a completely different house. He didn't, do you know what I mean? It was different sound, so I was kind of in limbo myself, as in, do I start listening to this more harder, more kind of, more, I don't know, I can't describe it more techno, but it's not techno, do you know what I mean? It's just deep tech kind of.
A lot of it I just call noise. Because it's got no melody, and I'm one for music with melody and soul and everything else. Some of it is just made for the dance or boom, boom, heads down stuff, but I like music with feeling, you know?
Yeah, true. And that's like I said, that's one thing I do remember about the sort of the ending of garage for me anyway. It was just like how I felt, using your words, the limbo. I just thought, where is the music going and what do I like? And you know, like the music kind of lost feeling and soul and that, do you know what I mean? So, yeah, I definitely agree with that. Right, since we're going to round off this little section about DJs, right, I want to know, right, if you can tell me as many DJs as you like, you know, you can go to town, it doesn't matter, but your favourite DJs, those that influenced you, those you listen to and you think, right, I'm going to listen to him so I can find out what's going on, and maybe DJs maybe you've discovered now recently as well, do you know what I mean? Because again, for me, I find that DJing is changing. There's so much new DJs now, do you know what I mean? So it's always interesting to find out who people are listening to right now, the new cats and that. So favourite DJs, ones that influenced you, probably ones, I don't know, just, you know what I mean, your favourite DJs.
I would say my favourite DJ at the moment is Neil Pearce.
Okay, Neil.
Of Remy.
Every time
I've heard him, he's mixing, he's bang on.
Neil's actually good, you know. He's actually, but then, I don't know, maybe again, it's my own personal opinion. Does he get the recognition?
No, he don't.
You know what I mean? But then that could be down to quite a few things, you know, but still, it's not for me to comment.
I think it's picking up now. It's definitely getting a little more recognition now from being Remy and the stuff he's doing with Ziggy Funk.
Okay.
In the studio and that, and some massive tunes and some of my favourite tracks
of
the last few years as well. I would say other DJs previously, LTJ Bookham for the drum and bass. Effortless mixing. No one touches Bookham mixing wise, and garage wise, probably Matt Jam Lamont.
Okay.
Because I know him better than any others, probably. I like his mixing style as well.
Okay. To be fair, when I think of the list, it's actually a good list. LTJ, for me, again, another unsung hero. Obviously, he gets his accolades and that kind of thing. Yeah. But I think deep down, when you hear people talk about drum and bass DJs sometimes, they will always mention Fabio, Groove Rider. You might get your Randalls. You might even get Jumping Jack Frost. But sometimes you never hear LTJ, but when you do, you always hear it from people who really appreciate the music. And then when they say his name, then you know. You know what, he's one of the top DJs that's been definitely, especially for in this country anyway. Okay, cool. So with DJing, right, everybody, again, I'm always going to refer to this point, right, our era, right?
Yeah.
Before it was, let me find the words, choose my words carefully here. Before you could actually just put it in the mix, before... This era, you had to work hard, hard with the turntable, trying, you know what I mean? And it was a difficult, I can remember first time getting on the decks, and I remember my hands feeling like Bambi on ice, and it was like running away, but you get used to, you get used to the pull and all of that things, and I think, like we were discussing just before we started shooting, was the change, and you know what I mean? People turning up to raise the laptop, and some people saying, no, you're not a DJ, and all this, but... Going back to that art era, anyway, especially like 90s, what was your first decks that you had?
First set of decks I had were a pair of Memorex belt drives. They had the little wheel on the front of them instead of the slider for the pitch control, a little wheel on the front of them.
Yep.
They were easy to use, but they were really, there's no pickup on them like you get on 1210s. You touch it, like you're saying, bam, you're nice, it just flies off. And if you... slightest little tap on the platter and it's stops.
Or jumpies.
Also, mixer was a realistic mixer from Tandy with no EQs on it, basically. So you mix it with no EQs and you wouldn't imagine it today, you know what I mean?
Listen, like for a lot of people probably who are getting to DJ now or going to the DJ, what I would say, past sort of the millennium, turntables, pitch, cartridges, these are the things that would probably be alien to you. But at one time, there was a normal, you know what I mean? And if you didn't have those, you know, you had to basically go and get them, do you know what I mean? But DJing has changed. So from the Memrex, I'm guessing there's only going to be one option really after 12 this.
12-10s, yeah.
Yep. And if anyone was wondering what techniques 12-10s are, Google it. Ask your dad, your uncle, your granddad. They will tell you that is the standard for DJs around the world. Yeah.
Direct drive turns. I was going any club and that's what they'd have.
I think that's the thing when I try to explain to people. It was, when I say standard issue, you go to a club. If you go to a club and they don't have techniques there, my advice to you is walk out. No, it's true. Walk out, because, you know what I mean? If you're especially coming from home and you've been playing on techniques, and then to go to a club, for example, another sort of decks that was around in the early days was Sound Labs. And Sound Labs was always the precursor to your techniques. Yeah. You know? Even if you got one technique, you're halfway there. But, you know what I mean? Everything else, for me, was substandard. You know what I mean? So
I said there was 350 quid at the time each. And I think 20, it was more than 20, that. 25 years ago.
I think there was about 600 each. Yeah. There was about 600, £1,200 you pay. And imagine.
15 years old. Yeah, to buy them,
that's what I'm saying. You go, I can remember that conversation never even happened with my mum. So I wasn't taking it to the shop to show her the price. Because even when I did get my own set, I got them years afterwards and it was like second hand. And obviously they was in good condition. But obviously everyone wants brand new stuff. But again, the money, even when you compare it now to this new stuff, it's just so expensive. But that's what it is. So techniques, and you probably had them for ages, didn't you?
Yeah, years, up till 2002, 2003, something like that, sold them. When I started getting back into DJing, I got Technics DZ1210s, which is the CD version.
Okay.
Which is the same sort of thing. They're using basically the same as the 1210s, but they're CDs rather than...
Okay.
And then on what I've got now, basically, which is I've got XDJs. 1000s.
Okay.
So the USB and the record box and Wi-Fi.
Oh, okay.
So there's no CD for them.
So are they the new ones?
Okay.
I saw. They don't take CDs now. Was it this year or last?
Yeah, this year.
Oh, this year. Okay. Wow. How much did that set you back then?
About 800 quid each.
Is it?
Yeah, brand new. But the thing is, that if you'll see upstairs. They're more or less the same as a DJ 2000, CDJ 2000, which is like $2,000. But they haven't got a CD.
Yeah.
Well, and they're less than half price. So it's a no-brainer, really.
It is a no-brainer, because I remember reading some comments and people were like, no, they want the CD. And I don't know. Me, personally, because I haven't really got a pair, so I can't really comment on which ones would I go for. But in terms of logistics, I'm thinking if I'm playing that, the ability to just kind of put everything on a USB stick and just roll.
Yeah, which is what a lot of people do these days, yeah.
And then again, going back to the days of Techniques 12-10s, you'd be carrying at least two record boxes and a record bag. To remove all of that and to put it down to a USB key and just go, I think it's a fantastic thing. And obviously, technology has done a lot for...
Especially as you're getting older.
Definitely.
You can't carry the record boxes
definitely.
Anymore.
I've got a bad back, so I could definitely not be carrying record bags. Since we're sort of still staying on the technology, right, there's been this debate, right, about these new equipment that's come out, where you've got a tractor, virtual DJ, and obviously, a little comment what you mentioned to me earlier about DJs using laptops. I've been out and I've seen just on a laptop, just pressing buttons, and that's what it is. But what's your take on this whole culture? Because again, like as we're discussing from our era, was DJing, you had to learn about it. And I think honestly, anyone who got to a Technics 1210s and started mixing straight away, you're a genius.
Yeah.
Most people, you'd have to learn, because like it's just a big learning process, i.e. getting used to the deck, getting used to the pitch, and, you know what I mean? And then just having the kind of confidence to just be in control. Yeah. You know, so like, we come from that era, do you know what I mean? And it's like, I've noticed just a lot of people who maybe, like you said earlier on as well, who call themselves DJ, and can they really call themselves DJ if they don't really know how to beat match properly? And yeah. Do you know what I mean? So what is your take on this kind of whole new sync culture that's kind of embraced us, you know?
Well, if obviously if you're using a sync button, it helps you get the two beats together, but it doesn't help you create a flow and select your tunes for you.
Mm.
So, oh well, saying that again, there is things that mixing key will tell you what key all the tunes are, like Record Box, where they can tell you what order of tunes to play. Mm. So if people are using that, that is cheating. But
that's the thing. You see what I'm saying? It the technology
takes
there,
a skill out.
Yeah,
of
it does. But then I don't know, because I'm trying to think. I'm just trying to say to myself, maybe there's a thing in that. Selecting the right playlist, but I think to myself, well, I don't know. I think DJing is more than that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you can might select the best playlist and put it together, and it makes sense and it sounds great. Yeah. But I don't know. DJing was about.
Is it going to work? That's the thing.
Well,
it's crowd reaction and all that. You can't do crowd reaction if you've got a whole selection already sorted. If you know where you're playing and you play there regularly, you know what the people want to listen to.
Of course.
Or you know the big tunes and you know what the crowd's going for. But if you're out of an area. And you've got a select list and no one's having it. You're, for want of a word, better word, buggered, really, ain't you?
This is it. But again, you know, like the young ones or maybe the younger generation, I don't know. That's what they're into now. Yeah. And like I said, that so for some of them, they probably wouldn't even be able to mix. Yeah. But they sort of rest in the idea that they can select the playlist or... select the tunes that are popular and keep the crowd going. Do you know what I mean? So I don't.
Well, they can't go back in time anyway, can they? Do you know what I mean?
No, that's true. No, that's the one thing I always say about technology. It brings us forward.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But there is an essence of something lost at the same time.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
When there's, like I said, waking up when I had my techniques, I'm there practicing with the same two tunes just to get it right.
Yeah.
And I'm playing with the pitch. You know, like, and I'm watching someone just come and just boom.
Yeah.
It's weird, but then at the same time, I've also seen people doing amazing stuff. Like now, it's like they'll get a few records played, but then they're taking bits out of the record,
trickery and all that. Yeah,
and then they start doing something. So it has, you know, gone a different way, and I don't mind it. But then again, at the same time, I kind of come from that era where DJs learn and there's the ability to hold the crowd.
Yeah.
Hold, because one thing I always remember we're going to rave was we always used to listen. Did he clang?
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Can't help it.
Yeah,
can't help
so
it.
we always looked out for the good DJs, the one who didn't clang, the one who rode
and
the beat.
If they don't, you're like,
yeah,
like,
you wince in it, so it's crazy. But yeah, it was always nice to get a different point of view, especially coming, like I said, we're coming from there a little bit generation when it was techniques and you know DJs were DJs, innit? So
as long as they're in it for the right reason as well, not to go, oh, look at me, I'm a DJ. As long as they're in it, the reason I play for is because I like to keep people happy. And if I'm playing and everyone's got a smile on their face and everyone's moving and I'm happy.
Of course.
Go,
oh,
look at me, I'm a DJ.
Yeah, no, but then the whole point of DJing is to bring joy.
Yeah,
just
exactly,
like music
yeah.
itself brings joy. So, you know, like I said, sitting up there and it's all about me, it kind of, that's not...
Ooh, look at me.
That's not what I did, speaking for myself. That's not the kind of culture I come from when it was about, we respected the DJs.
It's about the music.
But we were there for the music, because if we're not there, the DJs have got nothing. There's nothing
exactly,
for them,
yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it's all about the music. And you know what? It's been actually lovely talking to you, because you know why? Yeah, it's just nice to sort of not necessarily reminisce, but kind of reflect on the kind of journey in the past that we've sort of...
And taking the same paths and that.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? Because obviously, as we discussed, the music and how everybody got into it in that particular time, you know, hardcore, jungle, and then the rest, and then after that, everyone just goes their own different way. But it's been really interesting and refreshing, obviously, and it would be nice to also... hear your mix as well, which you guys will probably hear or seen the other video, the mix. So it'd be nice to see where he's at right now as a DJ, because obviously he's grown up, changed, life, everything.
I wouldn't say grown up, I got older.
He knows what I mean. But it'll be good, obviously, to see him as a DJ and just obviously hear the kind of style where he's at now. And with the Spinners Lounge, you know, I'm always happy to have everyone, and it's always a mission to get there and do this and arrange it with people. So, you know, Stuart, it's been cool, obviously, because we've been in this house, in this nice garden, we're chilling. So, just before we go, right, because we always try and keep this interview roughly short and not take up too much time. So, before we go, we always say to the DJs, look, sell yourself, right? And so we start off with social media, places where you've got your mixes online, and also if you're playing out, you was telling me earlier about these guys,
yeah,
so maybe
Fresh, Sweet, and Sexy, yeah.
What's that, what they're called?
Fresh, Sweet, and Sexy.
So Fresh, Sweet, and Sexy, yeah. Is there a promotion or
that's promotions, it's
mic up.
That's the promotion, and it's DJ Mr. CSP who runs it with his soon-to-be wife.
Okay.
And I've been resident with him for 4 years. We've done stuff around Shoreditch in Camden. But we're at the moment, he's looking at joining up with Whiskey Mist in Mayfair and linking up with Bump and Hustle from Bournemouth, which is Bob Povey and John Coomer. Linking up with them. We've done things with them in the past and that, so that's sort of going to be in the next few months and that. Also doing Vocal Booth for Andy Ward in September, which is a festival in Spain every year. Usually about 600, 700 people all come together for the same reason, for the love of a deep or soulful house music.
Yeah, quickly, with that September event with Andy Ward, where can people find more information on that?
VocalBoothWeekender.com, and there's also a Vocal Booth Weekender app, which is VBW app. You can get that on iPhone or your Android, and it's got all the information on there. I don't think there's any tickets left for this year, but it's been going 6 years, and it's like it's gone for another 6 years, and it's always getting better. There's like 100 DJs from all around the world playing everything they love. Pool parties all day, clubs all night, and for a whole week, so...
Sounds good, you know, mate. Sounds really
obviously, I can't do all day and all night. I'm getting on a bit now.
Yeah, definitely. Old age does take its toll, but it does sound like it's going to be a good little gig. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so,
mate.
Remember, guys, go to the website. He said there's no tickets, but I'm sure if they keep maybe checking, they might something pop up.
Yeah. If you just go on the Vocal Booth Weekender app, it's got all the information. You've got podcasts from the past events. I'm on there as well. Among loads of other good DJs. Tickets, he's got a merchandise store and everything else like that on there. So that's VocalBoothWeekender.com as well.
So go and check it out, guys, if you want to go to Spain in September, yeah? Right, so social media, where can people find and follow you?
Right, you can find me, you can follow me on SoundCloud, it's Stuart Mitchell. You can follow me on Mixcloud, Stuart Mitchell again. That's my name. Facebook. I've got a profile on Facebook. I think it's full now. So there's Stuart Mitchell 2 on Facebook. There's a group on Facebook, which is DJ Stuart Mitchell's Deep Soul Sanctuary, which is the name of my show, which I've been doing on radio for the last few years. Also on Instagram and on Twitter as well, under DJ Stu Mitchell. And you can follow me on there, and you can find links to my SoundCloud and everything all on my Facebook and all the other social media sites. There's hundreds of hours of stuff on there. Also, as well, Ustream, when I used to do SOS Radio for 4 years, nearly 5 years, we used to do it live video broadcast via Ustream.
Okay.
So there's about 100 hours worth of live videos of me DJing as well on Ustream.
Wow, excellent. I was just going to mention something, it's going to come to me. Radio station, you just said radio station. What's the name of the radio station?
At the moment, I've taken a break because a lot of things going on in my personal life at the moment. Till last November, I was doing London Live FM, which is based in West London.
Okay.
Also, and that was linked up with Amsterdam's Most Wanted as well, which is broadcast on the FM in Amsterdam. SOS Live, which is saveoursoul.es, which is based in Marbella in Spain. Mm-hmm. House Station Radio, which is based in Italy, which are becoming a bit of a force now in the scene with a lot of big names on the station. Soon be linking up with them again after I've had a couple of words with them. So,
so guys, you've got the social media, you've got the radio, you've got Fresh, Sweet and Sexy. You've got a Vocal Booth Weekender coming up in September. You've got Ustream. Go and check out Stuart Mitchell, yeah? It's a recommendation from me, from everyone at the Spinners Lounge and Audio Rock TV. And I'm going to say goodbye now. And you guys, just hopefully just go and watch the mix and hear him play. And hopefully you see me again for another episode of the Spinner's Lounge. So, guys, we're about to say peace and Audi.
Peace.
Later.